Now, for our first reading this evening, we are going to be looking at 2 Peter chapter 2 and starting at verse 10. That's 2 Peter chapter 2, starting at verse 10. And you can find this on page 1223 in the Red Church Bibles. That which Rich spoke on last week, this is especially true of those who follow the corrupt desire of the flesh and despise authority. Bold and arrogant, they are not afraid to heap abuse on celestial beings. Yet even angels, although they are stronger and more powerful, do not heap abuse on such beings when bringing judgment on them from the Lord. But these people blaspheme in matters they do not understand. They are like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct, born only to be caught and destroyed, and like animals, they too will perish. They will be paid back with harm for the harm they have done. Their idea of pleasure is to carouse in broad daylight. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their pleasures while they feast with you. With eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning. They seduce the unstable. They are experts in greed, an accursed brood. They have left the straight way and wandered off to follow the way of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved the wages of wickedness. But he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey, an animal without speech, who spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These people are springs without water and mists driven by a storm. Blackest darkness is reserved for them. For they mouth empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of the flesh, they entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise freedom, while they themselves are slaves of depravity. For people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in it and are overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and then to turn their backs on the sacred command that was passed on to them. Of them, the Proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to a wallowing in the mud. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Father, as we gather before your word, we pray that you would prepare us to receive it with a deep reverence and a willingness to apply it to our lives. Amen. Please do be seated. And if you find it helpful, please take up the handout in the notice sheet, and there's some questions on there to further ponder on after the service tonight. Now let's ring the bell for round 2 of the dismantling of false teachers. As you can tell from this passage, Peter's language is strong, isn't it? It's very strong. It's as if he's only just getting started at the end of verse 9, and he's rolled up his sleeves, ready to continue his condemning words about false teachers. Now, you can tell Peter has a pastor's heart, and he cares for God's people when you read through this passage, because he seems angry. But his anger is a righteous one. It's one that burns against the wickedness and vile nature of those who would distort the truth of God, who would make him out to be a liar and lead people astray. And we must remember that these aren't just the opinions of Peter. These are God's words. God is angry with false teachers. And when we examine exactly what it is that they are doing, it's not hard to understand why. So Peter continues from verse 10 through to 22, to show the false teachers for what they really are, so that we can spot them, so that we can avoid falling for them, and so that we don't end up like them. And he does this by showing us that they think like an animal, they act like an animal, and they will be treated like an animal. Now let's begin by examining their character in verses 10 through to 12. Bold and arrogant, they are not afraid to heap abuse on celestial beings. Now, what does it mean to heap abuse on celestial beings? Now, we honestly don't know. We have no clarity in what it exactly means and what it exactly is that these false teachers are saying. The celestial beings seem to be referring to the demonic. And I say that because of the contrast that's there between these beings and the angels from the Lord. And there is also an illuminating passage in Jude, verses 8 to 10, which seems to indicate that this is in reference to the demonic. So perhaps these false teachers claim that they have some sort of authority over the demonic. Maybe they think that they can slander them as ones who are greater. We don't really know. But whilst we don't know what they were exactly saying, what we do know is the manner in which it is being said. And that's the focus. And to say that these teachers were a bit up themselves is an understatement. They are extremely arrogant in their nature. Verse 11 continues, yet even angels, although they are stronger and more powerful, do not heap abuse on such beings when bringing judgment on them from the Lord. These false teachers are so shameless that they will literally go where angels fear to tread. Now, what should shock us is that they are so brazen that they presume an authority that even the angels don't administer, because it's an authority that belongs solely to God. The angels know their place. They are simply messengers. They don't make judgments, they deliver them. However, in the beginning of verse 10, we read that these false teachers, they despise all authority. All authority except that of their own. You see, whatever it is exactly that they are saying, they are making light of the supernatural. And they're making light, therefore, of God's judgments. That's why, even though presumably they're speaking against the demonic, they blaspheme in matters that they do not understand. They claim wisdom and authority, but really they are ignorant and irreverent. And the way in which false teachers treated God's judgments then is the same as they treat God's judgments and his word now. Now, why do they think like this? Well, at the end of verse 12, it tells us, they are like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct, born only to be caught and destroyed. And like animals, they too will perish. Now, it takes a special kind of arrogance to assert that which you don't know, and an even greater level of stupidity to abuse powers beyond our comprehension. Yet their boldness is in part due to their ignorance. For if they knew what they were doing, they would stop immediately and quiver in fear. But they don't, because they're like an unreasoning animal. You see, if you gave a pet dog a priceless work of art, maybe you have a painting, a beautiful painting, and you lay it out along the floor, what will they do with it? Well, they might chew at it, they might sit on it, they may even, in ignorance, foul on the canvas. Yet they'll never appreciate truly what it is that they're doing. They will never appreciate the art for what it is. They'll never appreciate the artist who created it with such flair and imagination. And they'll never appreciate how inappropriate their treatment of that artwork is. And so it is with false teachers and their treatment of God's word. Animals may have brains, but they are not rational beings. They make no contribution to the rational world. Instead, they are instinctual. They go where their stomach tells them. They don't have set principles or values. They have instinct, and their instinct is to adapt to their environment. And so it is with false teachers who play fast and loose with God's word and make adaptations to be more palatable to our modern ears. Now, we must be very wary of those who claim to speak sense in our modern times, yet have no reverence whatsoever for the word of God. Now, I've read recently a blog post from a false teacher who has started a series which is entitled, Does the Bible Really Say? And discusses certain topics, the first of which was homosexuality. Does the Bible really say? You know what that sounds like, don't you? It sounds like the serpent in Genesis 3, who undermined God's words by tempting Eve. Did God really say that? Don't be fooled by these false teachers. They don't try to conform the world to what God says. No, instead, they try to conform God to what the world says. They have no reverence for God and his word. They stand in judgment over him. And so we see them convene in their synod meetings. We see them gather at their 5 grand conferences. They appear on our television screens, and they make noises over the radio, and all the while they think they're so clever. They talk like they are the authority on spiritual matters, and yet they oppose the one who has ultimate wisdom and ultimate authority. Oh, they may come across as clever. They may seem nice. They may even have a great presence on social media. But to defy our holy God is about the most stupid thing you could do. They have no idea who they are messing with. And so we can see that they think like animals. But as we read on, we realize that false teachers also act like animals. In fact, this passage, there is a contrast made in which the animals are shown to have more about them than the false teachers. Now, we should be greatly troubled when we consider the conduct of these false teachers. For a start, in verse 13, they carouse in broad daylight. Now, whilst most people might try to hide their sin by darkness, these false teachers are so shameless that they don't care if the whole world sees what they're up to. In fact, they even get a kick out of the fact that their lifestyles are there for the whole world to see. The most shocking revelation, however, is at the end of verse 13. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their pleasures while they feast with you. You see, Peter is not just warning the church about the false teacher out there. He's warning them about the one at their dinner tables. These teachers are not competing with the true church. They're infiltrating the true church. And when we examine the severity of their actions, we're amazed at how this could be allowed to happen. Verse 14, they have eyes full of adultery. They see opportunities for perversion every single place they look. They never stop sinning, not for time of day, nor for the company that they keep. They seduce the unstable. It's the most vulnerable in the church that are being targeted by these false teachers. They are experts in greed. They know exactly how to turn their circumstances for profit. They are indeed an accursed brood. You see, we know a tree by its fruit. And the false teachers who think like animals behave like them too, because they run off instinct, and don't walk closely with the Lord. And as a result, it's the physical, not the spiritual, that will dominate their desires. In fact, Peter in verse 15 and 16 reminds us of the false prophet Balaam, who, because of his love for the material, had less prophetic wisdom than that of a dumb ass. And what do you think that makes him? You see, false teachers will seek money, sex, power, and an unwary church provides them with a place where they can obtain all these things in plain sight. Now, it would be good if we could say of the church today that we wouldn't be so blind as to let that sort of wickedness happen right in front of our noses. But we can't say that. In fact, the church today promotes their integration. Today, we call it mutual flourishing. The idea that, within the Church of England especially, differing views on so-called same-sex marriage, views on the existence of hell, and even the route to salvation can mutually grow together. Folks, it's nonsense. We don't want mutual flourishing. We want faithful teaching to flourish, and we want false teaching to die out completely. Now, I'm reminded of Melvin when he spoke at GAFCON last year on mutual flourishing. He said, imagine you had a garden and you maintained it by the principle of mutual flourishing. One way, you let the weeds grow up with the plants. What would you get? Well, you'd have a garden full of weeds like mine. And I mean mine, not Melvin and Heather's. That's not what you want at all. If you want a nice-looking garden, then you've got to pull up those weeds where you find them. And if we don't oust the false teaching from within the church, if we don't call false teaching out for what it is, then as far as the outside world is concerned, we're all on the same side. Maybe you don't think the situation is as bad as it was for the early church. Why then do we hear about paedophile priests, ministers involved in adulterous liaisons, pastors guilty of financial irregularities? You see, if we harbor false teaching, we unwittingly provide a safe haven for false living as well. And as Christ wants to present his church as a radiant one, without any stain and wrinkle, these false teachers are the blots and blemishes that need to be removed. Now, false teachers think like animals, and they act like animals. But what does Peter say will happen to them? Well, it follows that they will be treated like animals. Verse 12 says, they are born only to be caught and destroyed, and like animals, they too will perish. You see, even if we are weak in the task of rooting out false teaching from Christ's bride, the church, God will not fail to protect his people from the spiritual harm that they bring. By his judgment, they will perish. Now, what does it mean to be born only to be caught and destroyed? Is this an indication that God has prepared these people in advance for destruction? Well, I don't think that is the focus of Peter here. Rather, the illustration of false teachers that he's using, that are being like animals, it suggests that he's comparing them to the animals that you might have for food, that you might catch and kill for that purpose. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, quite simply, just as we have farm animals that best serve humanity as food, these false teachers best serve humanity when dead. And it's one of the most cutting analogies that I've come across in the Bible. Yet this reinforces how seriously false teaching is taken by Peter, and more importantly, by the Lord. God alone is the judge, and he will apportion the harm to them for what they deserve. Verse 13. Why is this so serious, though? When we read verse 17, we see how insidious false teaching really is. These people are springs without water and mist driven by a storm. Now, you can imagine the tragic disappointment to a traveler in the Middle East at this time. They come across a spring, they're so parched, they're so thirsty, only to find that it held no water. You see, that actually could be the difference between life and death for that person. Imagine then they saw a mist, maybe on the horizon, hopeful for life-giving rain. Yet unbeknown to them, it's being driven by a deadly storm. You see, so foul and wicked are false teachers that they promise hope and freedom, yet they deprive people of the life-giving water that is the good news about Jesus Christ. You see, we live in a spiritually dry world, totally barren because of our sin. And Jesus came into our world and said, "If anyone is thirsty, come to me and drink," John 7:37. But these false teachers promise their own brand of water. They say, "Drink this. You can keep your sinful lifestyle, that's fine. No major demands on your life, just drink this. If you drink what we're offering, you'll be fine." They may as well be offering these people a mouthful of sand. How perverse, how sick and twisted would you have to be in order to do that to someone? Now, I remember a chat I had with one of the members of this congregation quite recently. They commented that they hate, and they meant the word, they hate liberal theology because it robs people of hope after death. False teachers are robbing people. The false teachers aren't just wrong. Their theology, their lifestyles are cruel. And so Peter says the blackest darkness is reserved for them. As they have led other people astray, obscured the light of Christ to those who have fallen for their lies, they will not see even a sliver of God's light themselves. And for this life, they will remain enslaved to sin. Like dogs and pigs, they will return to that which made them ill in the first place and to that which made them filthy. Now, what can we do to guard ourselves and to guard those around us from ending up like them? We should crave the living water that Christ offers. Not just get a bit damp. This means that we must seek the teaching that is immersed in the scriptures, not just dip our toes in. You see, we must drink full and drink deep if we are to be spiritually satisfied. We must recognize that we learn in the Bible of the one true God, not a spiritual option as that track earlier suggested. We must recognize that he is a God of love and justice. He is both a holy God and a gracious one. He is the God of heaven, yet he is also the God of hell. We can't have one without the other. We can't appreciate our salvation without confessing our sin. We can't look forward to the next life while we're invested in this one. And we can't be a servant of God while we're still enslaved to our sin. Don't believe the lies of these false teachers. Friends, I implore you this evening, dive headfirst into the scriptures. Immerse yourself in them and drink until you're overflowing with the grace, love, and forgiveness that comes only from Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this clear warning about how dangerous it is to sit in judgment over your word. We pray that as we go out from this place, we would flee false teaching where we encounter it and crave the living water that only Christ offers. Amen.